The father of an Oma woman jailed for 2.5 years for an ISIS-related terror offence, as she has been the victim of a miscarriage of justice. Lorna Moore, who's 34 and from Mountjoy, was convicted at the Old Bailey for failing to tell the authorities that her husband was about to join the militant group. The court heard the Muslim convert had also been planning to bring her 3 children from their home in the West Midlands to live under the so-called Islamic State in Syria. Well, our investigations reporter Kevin McGee spoke to Noel Moore at his Tyrone farm, and Mr. Moore said his daughter only discovered that her husband had gone abroad after she returned from a holiday with their children, and he says his daughter is innocent.
That was a miscarriage of justice. It couldn't be anyone else. My daughter didn't know where the man was going.
Do you feel that she failed to tell the authorities about her plan, about his plans to join up with these militants?
No. I think the whole thing's rubbish, from start to finish. Somebody been accused of something that they didn't do and getting 2.5 years in jail for it, that she did not do.
The judge said that she knew perfectly well that he was dedicated to terrorism.
No, she would not. She wouldn't have known that. Definitely not.
He said that she told lie after lie.
Oh, that's wrong. That's 100% wrong. Anybody that come out with that there, that my daughter told a bit of lies and was away on holidays, come back, the man was away and didn't come back. He'd done the same the year before. He come back the year before. They didn't come back last year.
And the judge also said that one of the troubling things about your daughter was her facility for telling lies.
That's all lies. That whole thing. No, didn't tell no lies. I had no right to. It wouldn't be an issue to tell lies.
Did she know that he was planning a trip abroad?
Definitely not.
Did she ever plan to take your grandchildren to the Islamic State?
Not at all. She wouldn't take the exams. Not at all. No way would she have done that. She thought too much of her youngster to take them over there.
What about the grandchildren, Mr. Moore? What's the future for
I
the
grandchildren? I don't know what the future is now.
Are you concerned about their future?
Oh, my wife's over there now to see what she about the children. She should not be back till such time as something done about them. I don't know what's going to be done.
And how has this left you feeling, Mr. Moore?
How have you been feeling what happened to your daughter?
That's Noel Moore, their father of Lorna Moore, speaking to our investigations reporter, Kevin McGee. So how common are stories like this? Let's talk to Emma Webb, who's an expert in radicalisation from the Henry Jackson Society. Good morning to you, Emma.
Good morning, hi.
As we heard there from Mr. Moore, he strongly believes his daughter has been the victim of a miscarriage of justice and that she's completely innocent. The court in their ruling would disagree, but what's your take on this scenario?
Well, it's entirely natural that, he's her father, so it's entirely natural that he would presume her innocence, and I totally understand why he feels. It seems like a totally natural, normal response to have to your daughter being in prison for something, accused of something so horrible, as to take your grandchildren away to a war zone. But we obviously have to have faith in the legal process, and I'm more inclined to believe the outcome of a trial than I am the opinions of her father, which would rightly be quite distressed. So I'm inclined to side with the court's decision. And I think, presuming her guilt, which they found, that the sentence seems perfectly appropriate.
How common is this, Emma, this sort of scenario between a husband and wife? Is it possible that at one point Lorna Moore was somewhat, if you will, a blank page and she was radicalised?
It's something that you see quite often with, even if as far back as the Al-Qaeda networks, you find people who are converts from Christianity. You see the same thing happening in America, all over Europe, that you do have these relationships that sort of catalyse and facilitate radicalisation. And it's a small number of steps that takes a person from just being in a relationship and perhaps being quite vulnerable to being able to sort of transition to such extreme views. I think with the instance of a woman like Lorna, there are other examples of vulnerable young women, but also, I mean, to say that a person is vulnerable, it almost detracts from the fact that they do have, you know, the volition
culpability
to make that. Yeah, of course, they have their own volition. They're responsible for their own views, but that they, when you have someone who is a convert, specifically converts, have particular vulnerabilities that you might not find with somebody who was born and raised a Muslim. So when you have a sort of lived religion, you have certain natural safeguards, certain filters through which you can filter the information being handed to you either by online propaganda or by your partner. And those sort of theological defenses, your ability to reason and distinguish between faith and religion and sort of sick propaganda that's being handed to you, you have those facilities more if you're someone who's been raised and you're raised in a Muslim community. You have certain sort of circuit breakers, as it were, that will stop you from going too far in one direction.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I think that that converts are more inclined to seek after a sort of a pure form of the religion, which bypasses the lived, nuanced, because they have to
improve themselves. Do you mean?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
They have a sort of investment in proving their piety, because it's almost as if they're latecomers to the religion, and therefore they need to make some extra efforts in order to prove themselves.
Because you do have to wonder what would possess a mother of three young children to think it would be okay to take those children to Syria to live under Islamic State.
I think in trying to understand the motivations of, I mean, this goes just beyond looking at the sort of psychology behind why a convert would go into such extreme measures, but also the attraction that there is from Islamic State for women. If you think of the early Al-Qaeda network, sort of Hamas, Hezbollah, there was always this internal discussion about the place of women, whether or not a woman can be a martyr. If she dies, will she go to heaven, and so on. And the women's roles were less combative and more of a supportive role. They were the wife or the mother of a martyr, whereas ISIS are specifically targeting women. And their propaganda shows, you see women with AK-47s and suicide belts holding severed heads. There was a Malaysian woman, for example, who tweeted about having a stethoscope around her neck and a Kalashnikov over her shoulder.
Okay.
And so the Islamic State is not, in the way that the earlier Al-Qaeda networks were, sort of these grainy propaganda images of men in caves, and it was more focused on men. Whereas now ISIS are giving women a place, and it's not just a terrorist enterprise. It's a state-building sort of utopian political state that they're trying to build, and women obviously have a role in that, not just as baby factories, as it's been said, but they have the Al-Qanza Brigade, for example, of an all-women police force. So you can see why, as anybody would be attracted to a totalitarian utopian state, that women have this sort of desire to go there and bring their children into this pure state, because they regard the West as filthy and disgusting.
Thanks very much for joining us. Emma Webb there, an expert in radicalisation from the Henry Jackson Society.